knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We've spent the past few tutorials going over different types of cnidarians, and with the most popular classes covered, it's time to wrap things up by looking at some particularly interesting species. The Myxozoans, or slime animals, were first discovered in the 1880s, and originally classified as protozoans, since all of them are obligate parasites. Many are single-celled, and at least one, Hanagaia salminicola, a common salmon parasite, is incapable of aerobic respiration. So the argument was that since they do not meet all the characteristics of animals, they are not animals. This made sense, except that Myxozoans have polar capsules, which closely resemble nematocysts, organelles that are found in no other creatures except cnidarians. This was originally attributed to convergent evolution, where two unrelated organisms develop similar characteristics, like wings evolving in both birds and bats. However, further genetic analyses revealed that the Myxozoans are actually highly derived cnidarians that evolved into single cells from free-swimming jellyfish-like ancestors, making them animals. Myxozoans have complex parasitic life cycles that involve an intermediate or secondary host, usually a fish, but sometimes an amphibian, reptile, bird, or mammal, and a definitive or primary host, usually worms or bryozoans. Myxozoans inside infected intermediate hosts are characterized by the cell-in-cell state, where the daughter cells develop directly inside the mother cells. These parasitic cells divide and spread via the nervous or circulatory system and eventually produce myxospores that leave the intermediate host. The myxospores are then consumed by the definitive host, where they attach to the lining of the gut epithelium using their nematocysts, or polar filaments, and multiply. They eventually produce sexual stages and release spiny actinospores that exit the definitive host, usually by the anus, and float in the water column. If the actinospores come into contact with skin or gills of a suitable intermediate host, they penetrate into the epithelium to cause a new infection. Though most myxozoan parasites do not harm their intermediate hosts, some are increasingly damaging wild fish stocks. They are perhaps most infamous due to their economic impact on commercially valuable fishes. Myxobolus cerebralis, for example, causes whirling disease in both farmed and wild salmon and trout. Whirling disease causes skeletal deformities and neurological damage that forces infected fish to whirl in an awkward corkscrew-like pattern, making feeding difficult or impossible. Other myxozoans target the muscle tissue, creating slime-like cysts. Living fish do not show symptoms of infection, but after death, their flesh becomes extremely soft, slimy, and inedible due to myoliquefaction. Other diseases caused by myxozoans include proliferative kidney disease, enteromyxosis, proliferative gill disease, and many others. The sister taxon of Myxozoa is Polypodiozoa, which was discovered in 1871 by Professor Ovsjannikov in the eggs of the Volga sterlet, Accipenser ruthenus, and by now is found in almost all species of the order Accipenseriformes, where it severely compromises reproduction capacities. Unlike Myxozoa, the only known species of Polypodiozoa, Polypodium hydriformi, is multicellular and found in freshwater. Its life cycle consists of a parasitic and free-living stage. A unique cnidarian, it is adapted to intracellular parasitism inside the oocytes, or immature egg cells, of accipenseriform fish, such as sturgeons and paddlefish. Inside the infected oocytes, the binucleated parasitic cell, which has two nuclei, one small and one large, forms a two-cell stage. This process of endocytokinesis happens when the small nucleus inside the binucleate cell becomes surrounded with a tiny portion of cytoplasm. The smaller internal cell divides, passes a morula stage, and then becomes an inverted planula and stolon with tentacles on the inside. The external region has the ability to consume the cells of its host and is called a trophamnion. Development of polypodiozoa within the oocytes of its host is strongly correlated with the progress of oogenesis in the host fish and is triggered by it. This means that the development of the parasite depends on the sexual development of its host. Finally, right before the host fish spawns, the parasitic stolon inside the infected egg turns inside out, and just after spawning, begins its free-living, non-parasitic life stage. The long stolon asexually splits into numerous fragments, yielding free specimens that walk on the substrate using their tentacles and form sexually reproductive gonads to infect new hosts. And with that, we conclude our study of the phylum Cnidaria, which was probably quite a bit more involved than you anticipated. As fascinating as this was, we have only scratched the surface on Kingdom Animalia, so let's continue working our way through the major animal phyla.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.